And it's fantastic to see so many people here tonight. This morning, it's not tonight. This morning, actually. And you're all, of course, very welcome to this seminar or lecture with Mr. Loic Vacant, who is a professor of sociology in Berkeley at the University of California.
First of all, I'd like to thank Uwe and the university and the Folkets Hus here for hosting this event. I must say also I feel sort of awkward and ill at ease because with this contraption on my head, I feel like I'm an employee of a telephone company or the online service for some shop where you bought something and you're calling me to protest or to exchange the goods. Hopefully I'll be able to exchange them and give you something to your satisfaction. I especially want to thank Uwe because of his patience and persistence for making this visit possible. It's my first time in Göteborg, and it's been a wonderful visit. Last night, after I arrived from the train, he took me to this old bathhouse where I went to the gym, swam, and went to the sauna. And I realized I have to do this every time I go in a city lecture. So I'll call this the Göteborg rule now. When you invite me, you have to provide this triple play for me to be relaxed. It's especially good to be here at the People's Public Hall because it's always a privilege to speak outside of a campus and to reach an audience extending beyond your colleagues and your students. Now, there are times when social science has to be modest and careful, and this is what we call, in Thomas Kuhn's term, the time for normal science, where you need to dig deep into a small problem and elaborate methodologically and be very rigorous and narrow and technical. And then there are times when you need a little to step outside of these parameters of normal science, where you have to be intrepid, you have to take risks, you have to go beyond what we can be sure about. And I think right now we live in a period where we need a bit of intrepidity in the social sciences. We need to go beyond what we can be sure about. We need to essentially return to the big picture. In particular, return to the big picture as the classical sociologists, the Marx, the Durkheims, and the Webers, and the Bourdieus of the world were able to take in and to face. We need this intrepidity and perhaps even intellectual arrogance to paint this big picture, to be able to characterize our era, the type of society that we live in, the nature of the transformation that we are witnessing, that we are in the midst of. And this is what I'm going to try to do today by taking you through the trilogy of books that I have written in the past decade, synthesizing work that I've been doing since around 1990, so essentially two decades of work. It's also for me a way of looking back and trying to explain to myself as well as to you what I have been up to as I complete this research program and I'm about to launch into sort of a new phase in my work. Very quickly, what I want to say is that we have exited an era that roughly we can call the century of 1880 to 1980, the long industrial, capitalist industrial 40s Keynesian era. And we all know that we have left that, but we don't know what we have gotten into yet. And so what I'm going to try to do is to provide you with my diagnosis and provide you with concepts and analytic tools to try to understand and to put together the different elements of the current social transformation, which involves the world of work, the world of the family, the world of the state, and the transformation of the city. I'm going to try to sort of piece these three or four things together to give you this picture. So, but very quickly, and this is, you're going to see that I'm going to evoke things that you've observed in your everyday life, or that you've observed, that you've read about in the news, or that you've seen in the media, and that have perhaps puzzled you. And I think that every element that I'm going to list now is something that most of you will be familiar with. where I think I bring added value, hopefully, is by showing how these different elements fit together and how they're part of a single major transformation. And if I had to summarize this transformation, I would say it's the rise of the society of social insecurity, capped and managed by the neoliberal state. And I'm going to essentially move us towards a sociological characterization of neoliberalism. So I think we used to live in a society first that between 1880 and 1980, for that long century, essentially it was a society that was first anchored by what we can call Fordist wage work. Fordist wage work means, you know, for the vast majority of the population, unskilled wage labor, oftentimes done in factory, and essentially organized around the framework that I call the 40-50-60 framework. You work 40 hours a week, for about 50 weeks of the year, you know, an average over the 20th century. That's about how much vacation, paid vacation, people in Western societies had. And then until you're 60, and that's essentially the anchor of your life, of your life trajectory. It's also the anchor of family formation, and is the anchor of the mode of reproduction of households. And for the vast majority of households, which means working class households, you know, this was essentially the anchor that organized, or that to which everything else was tied. Tied to that, there was the very importantly the so. As we know, the capitalist economy is a cyclical economy that goes through boom and bust, and so there were periods of unemployment and hardship. In those cases, helping to stabilize and working hand in hand with this Fordist wage work was what we can characterize as very roughly as a Keynesian state. And again, you know, coming at different speed, with different degree of completeness in the different societies, earlier and more fully active in the Nordic countries, less so in the Anglo-Saxon countries, sort of intermediate for the countries of continental Catholic conservative Europe. What you had a state essentially that helped stabilize the economy and the society when the cycles were down. So when the cycles were down, the Keynesian state would be a mildly redistributive state, but a protective state that would protect, in particular, vulnerable households from the sanction of the labor market, would help redistribute purchasing power, and then help speed the return to the upcycle of the economy. And then along with that, too often we forget that, we leave that too much to our colleagues, oftentimes women sociologists, to worry about the family and gender, and I think it's a regrettable split in the organization of the social sciences. Very importantly, along with that, there was the patriarchal nuclear family. And essentially, the patriarchal nuclear family worked hand in hand with Fordist wage work and with the Keynesian state. And then lastly, there's an aspect that, again, I think we don't pay enough attention to, and I haven't paid enough attention to in my own work. I think there was also, back in this long century, very rigid authoritarian age-graded relations. The relations between adults and children, in particular, were essentially, you know, dictatorial relationships ruled by, you know, the principle of the ultimate authority of the parents, who simply could dictate to children or to young people in general what they had to do. And what has happened after 1980, and again, you know, earlier in some societies, a little bit later in other societies, we could go into the sort of comparative sociology of this transition, is all four of these elements entered into a crisis, and the system that they formed came unglued, and then the different elements came apart, and then what replaced each of these different elements, in a sense, didn't work well with the other elements, and so this creates, in a sense, a state of structural disunity, a structural confusion, if you wish. Wage work, starting and accelerating in the mid-70s, Fordist wage work was essentially replaced by polarized occupational structure, and by, for those who are at the bottom of the class structure, by essentially either high unemployment, permanent joblessness, deproletarization, or casualization. And essentially, you know, the formula 40-50-60 wasn't replaced. That's part of the problem. It wasn't replaced by a particular formula. Rather, what you've seen is the multiplication of legal frameworks, overseeing forms of wage employment. For instance, in a country where the labor market is supposed to be as regulated as France, where, you know, periodically the OECD will put out a report saying, bemoaning the rigidity of the French labor market. In reality, in France right now, you have 24 different formulas under which you can hire wage workers. You've had the shortening and the diversification of the temporal horizon of wage workers, in particular with the rise of part-time employment and short-term contracts, where essentially you enter into the wage-labor relationship, but you no longer have this long-term framework where you can project yourself into the future, you can build a household, you can think about, you know, maybe acquiring a home and so on and so forth, because work itself has become the vector of social insecurity. Work itself, by becoming unstable, by fragmenting, the fragmentation of wage labor has brought about structural social insecurity for those at the bottom of the labor market who have nothing but, in a sense, their labor power to sell, who are, you know, in a sense, the unskilled fractions of the post-industrial proletariat or the post-industrial working class. And so this fragmentation of wage labor has, you know, has led to this. Whereas the 40-50-60 framework used to be a vector of objective solidarity and commonality of life paths for all those who enter into wage labor now itself has become a vector of fragmentation and of diversification and of disunity among the wage earners. And I could go and elaborate this. You've had the pulverization of work relationships with the rise in particular of the extreme forms of temporary day labor, for instance, you know, is something that's become important in most advanced societies, where being a worker now is a negative identity, not a positive identity. It used to be between 1880 and 1980, you were, as part of the 40-50-60 framework, you had a sense of the dignity of being part of a collective, of being the builders of the world. And essentially, that positive working class identity has disappeared nearly everywhere. And it's been replaced essentially by a negative identity. If you're a wage earner without skills, that is, without credentials and the ability to compete for the protected job positions, essentially now you're not one of two things. And you can find it in the language that working class people use all over the world. In particular, in the US, they use the language, I'm not a slave. I'm not a slave, or I'm not a Mexican. And essentially, you know, it doesn't say, I am something positive. You say, I am not one of these awful things. And this is important. And so we've seen the symbolic fragmentation of the working class as we have historically known it and as it came to form itself and to organize itself in the period 1880 to 1980. And so alongside with the unmaking of wage labor, the fragmentation of wage labor, we've seen a transmission of family, and I don't have to go into this, but essentially the diversification of family forms, the questioning of the official definition of families as the married heterosexual couple and so on and so forth. So we've had sense turmoil around the very definition of what counts as a family, what counts as marriage. And I think we've also had a dramatic transformation of the age-graded relationships. It used to be, you know, that children were pets, or were in a sense, you could say, you could argue, were, you know, the subjects of their parents, or were the subjects of adults in general. That is, you could discipline a child or an adolescent on the streets, in the public space, and so on. If he misbehaved, you could slap him, you could order him to behave, and so on and so on. That era, as you know well, I don't have children, but I observe my nieces and nephews very closely. As you know well, and I can see some smiles in the room, that era of having children who are subjects is over. Some of you might argue we have become the subjects of the parents. But essentially it means that, you know, now with the and it's a cultural transformation that leads to considering children as, in a sense, miniature version of adults with their own rights, with their own vision, with their own, you know, ability to construct themselves. It means, of course, that old authoritarian relationships don't work. It means that this doesn't work in the family, but also it doesn't work at school. And much of the turmoil that school systems are going through has to do with the evaporation of these old authoritarian subject relations in which children were caught, but also means that in public space, in particular, this has influence on delinquency, as you can imagine. In public space, you know, children or adolescents, teenagers, don't feel under the generalized guardianship and oversight of the adults around them. You know, if you see a teenager misbehaving in the streets of Gothenburg, not only can you not slap him, but if you intervene, he'll probably, you know, he might even call his parents, and his parents are going to be mad not at them, but mad at you for intervening and intruding upon, you know, the sacred province of the self of that sacred being that children have become. So, and I think along with that, we need to think more about how the transformation of the relationships that we have with people at the very beginning of life and at the very end of life. So there's been this general transformation. So if you put together these, and then lastly, and it's important, it's something that myself, I have underestimated in my own work, or I haven't sufficiently explicated. I think there's been, alongside with the dramatic transformation of wage work, the shift from Fordist wage work to fragmented wage labor, along with the transformation of family forms and forms of sexuality and conflicts over the definition of proper sexuality and so on and so forth, along with the transformation of age-related relationships, there's been the shift from a direct mode of reproduction of the working class, where it used to be that working class kids would simply be taken to the local factory by their parents and get a job. They didn't need to go through the school system, to a school-mediated mode of reproduction, to where even access to low-wage labor now requires having finished your secondary education and may even require having some post-secondary education. And what we've seen in the essentially between 1980 and today, and again, you know, earlier in some societies and a little bit later in other societies, and in some societies still not yet completed, what we've seen is the generalization of the school as the means of access to valued work position, but we've seen the generalization of schooling without the generalization of the means of being properly schooled, and without sufficiently equal distribution of cultural capital that will allow working class parents to tutor and to understand what their children are going through. And this has had a dramatic dissolving effect on the traditional forms of working class organization. Because the school system is essentially a machinery that teaches people to think of themselves as individuals. It's an extraordinarily powerful individualizing agency that essentially leads you to see yourself as a little vessel, as a little entrepreneur of your own life. You know, you will, by your own exertion, determine your own fate, and you will be responsible for your own fate. Therefore, you shouldn't identify or worry about what's happening to others. You should worry about what's happening to you. And I think that you know, in the general rise of urban marginality and inequality and social turmoil in contemporary society, much of that turmoil comes from the experience of this generalization of schooling that has translated into great despair and distraught and, in a sense, cultural disorientation for working class kids, but has translated also in intense anxiety for middle class families, because the middle class essentially used to have a monopoly over the school system. And essentially it was guaranteed that if it sent their children to the school system, they would come out with degrees, and their degrees would guarantee a good job and a good life, and thus working class, middle class households would transmit their status safely through the school system to their children. And what has happened is that with the fragmentation of wage labor, we've seen the rise of objective social insecurity and poverty at the bottom of the class structure. But we've seen also the rise of subjective social insecurity and social anxiety in the middle reaches of the social structure as middle-class households fear being brought down, they fear downward mobility, and they fear not being able to transmit their middle-class status to their children as the competition for schooling has increased, and as going to school and even going to the university no longer guarantees getting a job, as getting a job doesn't guarantee that this job will last. Even if this job lasts, there's no guarantee that the income will be sufficient to purchase the package of goods and services that warrant and that signify middle class status. And so what you've had a polarization of the class structure under this transformation, with rising poverty, entrenched poverty, intense objective social insecurity at the bottom, the inability to project yourself in the future, the fact that now essentially, you know, either unemployment or part-time employment or insecure employment has become the mainstay of the normal horizon of work for the unskilled fractions of the working class. But you've had great social anxiety and subjective social insecurity among the middle classes. And then at the very top, you've had an astounding expansion of the life chances of those who possess what? The two forms of capital, not just one, not just economic capital, but those who possess economic and high, scarce forms, highly valued forms of cultural capital. There's been an extraordinary expansion of their life chances. I mean, if Scott Fitzgerald was coming back to observe today the life of the rich and beautiful at the top of Swedish or French or British or American society, he would be astounded. His novels just don't, you know, match the level of wealth, the level of opulence, the sense of eminence, the sense of entitlement, and the extraordinary globalization of the life chances and life space of the upper class. And, you know, and I must say, this lecture facing you is part of, has benefited greatly from this extraordinary expansion. If you have a professional, you know, degree in a highly valued skill in the contemporary society, if you have a degree from an elite school, suddenly, instead of being, you know, having your traditional career in your one line or in your one country, suddenly you have a career path and career possibilities all over the world, you know, and you've had an extraordinary expansion. So we've had this polarization of the class structure, rising objective social insecurity at the bottom, translating into despair, and now I'm going to go into the deeper analysis of urban marginality. This social anxiety, remember, it's very important, and subjective insecurity at the middle, and this sense of entitlement and eminence, and even you, one could argue, sort of the social secession of the globalized upper class. And so what I'm going to do now that I've set this overall picture is to go into the guts of some elements of this transformation, leading me at the end to come to the one element. You will have noted that I've left one element. What happened to the Keynesian state? And the Keynesian state, I would argue, sense, was reformed from within, by the state nobility, by the agents of the state. This is one of the most remarkable elements of that political transformation. It wasn't a political transformation as we are witnessing today in, let's say, in the Arab countries, that came from the outside. It was a revolution from within the state nobility, from within agents of the state, who came to rethink their vision of what the state is for, what its perimeter should be, what its priorities should be, what its modalities of intervention should be. And so from within the state, we had a sort of palace revolution, if you wish. We had a palace revolution of people inside the state who decided that they would transform the state essentially from an instrument of protection to an instrument of discipline, particularly when it comes to the poor, and who then, having re-engineered the state, used the state to fashion the social space and the society in the image that they had. And this political revolution from within, this political revolution from above, is what I will characterize as neoliberalism. And I'm going to, in a sense, take us through the trilogy that looks at the relationship between class transformation, and this is the relation in particular built on the market and on the labor market, you know, and you can use a Marxist definition of class as position in the relations of production, or you can use a Weberian definition as market capacity. It doesn't make any difference in the overall diagnosis. And so what I became concerned, what I wrote this trilogy about, is the transformation of the relationship between class transformation on the one hand, ethnic division. Now, ethnicity is forms of classification and stratification that are rooted in social estimations of honor. So here we have a material hierarchy based in position in the relations of production, market capacity, and here we have a symbolic hierarchy based on the gaze, based on how we perceive people to be, how good we perceive them to be, how similar to us do we perceive them to be. And ethnicity comes in multiple variants. There you have, historically, ethnicity arises as essentially we are part of the same religion. So you have ethno-religious identity, then you have ethno-linguistic identity, then you have this invention of this notion of the nation, you have ethno-national identity, and somewhat simultaneous to that, you have the invention of ethno-racial identity, the idea that the biology, the people's physical makeup, determine them to be in different categories. But essentially, all of these ethno-national, ethno-racial, ethno-linguistic, ethno-regional, they're all gradations of honor in social estimation of honor in the definition given by Max Weber. And so what I came to be interested in, and how this started, I landed in Chicago and I was faced with the reality of the black ghetto right at my doorstep, and I became puzzled in how it is that people can live in this universe, and what is this universe about, and how can I understand the transformation of the class structure of black American society after the 1960s and continued racial separation and division of American society. And so it's started out as an inquiry into the transmission of the ghetto after the 60s, and the ghetto being the territory of relegation par excellence of American society, that is the neighborhood that is positioned at the bottom of the system of places, then I wanted to compare it, to compare its evolution to the neighborhoods that are also the neighborhoods at the bottom of the system of places in the Western European city. And these I would call classical working class territories. The working class territories of the urban periphery, you know, in a sense, are the structural analog to the Black American ghetto. And so I compared these working class territories, and I took the case of the banlieue of France, these territories of this declining, traditionally working class areas, turning into immigrant areas, either in reality or in perception, and who are not only stigmatized in public discourse, but are also the site of the turmoil, including, as you know very well, the 2005 wave of rioting that lasted 3 weeks. But that essentially was only a temporal compression and a spatial expansion of a pattern of rioting that had existed for 20 years. And so I wanted to understand the social transmission of the ghetto and compare it to the So here what we have is essentially the collapse of the Black American ghetto and its replacement by a dual structure of segregated Black middle-class neighborhoods at the top and what I call the hyper-ghetto at the bottom. And if I have more time, and we can return to that diagnosis. But essentially, it's arguing that the ghetto has collapsed as a social form and has been replaced by this new socio-spatial contraption of which the hyper-ghetto, doubly segregated by race and class, and now a territory emptied of its economic function, no longer serving to extract Black labor for the industrial economy, and no longer having its complement of communal institutions to protect its residents in a separate city that Blacks were running of their own, the Black city within the white, and essentially where the communal institutions are replaced by the social control institutions of the state, and in particular the penetration of the penal state. And in the working class territories of Western Europe, what I observed is essentially the pauperization and stigmatizations of these areas, but not a pattern of convergence with the Black American ghetto. And indeed, I refute the thesis of convergence. And in lieu of the thesis of convergence, I argued that, in fact, these areas are becoming anti-ghettos. If anything, they're moving away from the pattern of the ghetto, and I'll be happy to clarify that murky point later in the discussion. But essentially, what I discovered is that a new regime of urban marginality was emerging. I refuted the thesis of convergence and I put forth the thesis of emergence. Emergence of a new regime of urban marginality, different from the regime of urban marginality of the 1880 to 1980 that corresponded to the society that I described earlier of Fordist wage work, nuclear patriarchal family, rigid age-graded relationships, the no need to go through the school system for class reproduction, and the Keynesian welfare state. And what I discovered, in a sense, much to my own, or somewhat to my own surprise, and certainly I hadn't started with that hypothesis, is that the state is the crucial agency that determines the form, the intensity, the social and the spatial distribution of urban marginality. And this is true not only for Western Europe, which most analysts would grant, but this is true also for the United States. I would argue even, this is even more true for the United States. That is, the state plays an even more pivotal role in determining the intensity and the social and spatial distribution of urban marginality in the United States, in particular because the state... So what I discovered is, in order to understand the new emerging form of... So this is what I call advanced urban marginality. An advanced urban margin, and this is summarized, and essentially I've just given you the 3-minute summary of the book Urban Outcast. This is the first book. The first book mines the base of this triangle and tries to understand the interaction between class transformation and ethnic division, ethno-racial division in the United States, ethno-national division, in a sense concerning with the target group or the group that is most affected by this transformation being Black Americans in the United States, because they're at the bottom of the system of ethnic order and ethnic honor, and post-colonial migrants in Western, in the European Union. And so this is Urban Outcast. This is, in a sense, volume one, tries to understand that, and then the discovery is that you need to bring in the state. So you're not, in a sense, talking about, I started out with only this element, you know, the base, the horizontal relationship, and then I discovered, well, there's this horizontal relationship, there's also the vertical relationship, and in fact, the vertical relationship mediates how class and ethnic division interplay. And actually, this is a generic property of the social world. And I presented this 2 days ago in Uppsala. And in order to remember it, because it came in the lecture, I said, we'll call this the Uppsala hypothesis. Is that every institution has a vertical dimension, a dimension of hierarchy, and domination of superordinate and subordinate, but oftentimes hidden even to the best sociologists, there's always a horizontal relationship of equality and communality and reciprocity and I think this is part of this Uppsala hypothesis. But so what then it meant is that I had to bring in the state into my model. I'm not a student of the state. I didn't start out as a political sociologist. I was forced to become a political sociologist because I couldn't understand the rise of advanced urban marginality if I didn't bring in state structure and state policy. And now I characterize urban marginality in the book. I give 6 synchronic properties and 4 drivers, and I'm not going to bore you with these 10 elements. But let me just single out three distinctive features of advanced marginality that distinguish, being working class and poor in Gothenburg today, or in Lyon or in Manchester or in the south side of Chicago, with being working class and poor, in the 1930s or in the 1950s, as late as the 1970s in most societies. 3 distinctive features is first that this urban marginality, I call it advanced marginality because it's not the result of backwardness. It's not an inheritance from the past. It is not a transitional phenomenon that will vanish in a few years, as politicians keep telling us, wait until we create, full employment. And, periodically you have politicians telling us we are about to back to full employment. Sarkozy, when he started his presidency in 2007, announced that he would bring full employment. The official unemployment rate today in France is over 10%. And we're expecting maybe another 1 million unemployed in the coming year. So clearly this hasn't happened. This I call it advanced marginality because it's, in a sense, it's the way of the future, and it has been produced by the most advanced sectors of the economy, not by the most backward. And we are going into more of it, not less of it. And the more the financialized sectors of capitalism progress, the more technological upgrading, the more the internationalization of exchange, and the greater this form of urban marginality, absent other, of course, interventions, in particular of the state, because since I said that the state is this, advanced marginality, to put it very tersely, is economically underdetermined and politically overdetermined. So, what I just said, there's going to be more of it, it's going to be more entrenched, it's going to be more visible, it's going to create more turmoil. I think England discovered that last August with its wave of riots. Of course, it depends crucially on what the state is going to do. Okay, but the three characteristics of advanced marginality are that it's fueled by the fragmentation of wage labor. And in a sense, so long as you're going to have the continued fragmentation of wage labor, you're going to get this, you're going to generate more of this advanced marginality. Second, it is fueled also by the retraction, recoiling, devolution, and disarticulation of the social welfare state. And thirdly, it is characterized by intense territorial stigmatization, the rise of stigma attached to being from a particular place, and typically what are these places? The collapsing Black American ghetto on the one side, and the declining, degraded, decomposing working class territories on the other side. I don't have to, everybody in this room knows of the neighborhoods of Rinkeby, they know Rosengard in Malmö, even if they've never been there, and they know that these are the urban hellholes, these are the problem neighborhoods, the territories of violence, of segregation, of vice, of dissolution, that are a problem for the country, for their residents, for everybody. And suddenly, so living in one of these areas, not only do you have to suffer from poverty and a closed future, but you have to suffer from the indignity of living in a place where everybody knows that only the rejects of society would tolerate living. And so there's this added burden, this added symbolic burden. And again, you see, I'm trying to hold together the material side and the symbolic side, and that's one of the principles of Bourdieu's sociology, is that you have to hold the material and the symbolic moment always closely together, interwoven with one another. So essentially, this is advanced marginality. It's economically underdetermined, politically overdetermined. Which means, of course, this raises the question, what will states do when they are faced with the entrenchment of this advanced marginality that they have created by deregulating the economy, by which means re-regulating the economy in the favor of firms. Don't be deceived that deregulation means less state or the state withdrawing or ceasing to act. No, it means the state redeploying its actions in a different way and reshaping the framework under which labor is purchased and extracted and produced. Because of course labor has to be produced. This is where the school system plays a major role. You only have the labor that you need to the extent that the state provides the educational system that will provide the skilled labor that is needed for the economy and so on and so forth. So how will the state react to the rise of advanced marginality that paradoxically it has created largely by deregulating the economy and shrinking the social safety net? And so this is where we come to Part 2 and Volume 2. Put tersely, the reaction of the state is to effect a punitive shift. The state pivots, you could argue, from the left to the right, from its protective wing to its disciplinary wing. And this pivoting, this punitive turn, is effected in both realms of the state, or what with Bourdieu we'd call both hands of the state. In Bourdieu's framework, there's the left hand of the state is the protective side of the state. It's the Ministry of Labor that regulates employment. It's the Ministry of Social Welfare. It's the Ministry of Social Housing. It's the Ministry of Education. It's the provision of childcare. It's the provision of elder care, and so on and so forth. So this is the left hand of the state, the hand that protects and those who are shorn of economic and cultural capital. And then you have the right hand of the state. And in Bourdieu's model, the right hand of the state is incarnated by the Ministry of the Economy and the Ministry of the Budget or the Treasury, which imposes new stiff budget discipline on the left hand of the state and then says, you are spending too much money and you are spoiling people. You must shrink your protective net so that people will compete and enter in this new economy that requires these rational agents that will now be on the competitive system of exchanges. And so what we see is a shift from the left hand to the right hand of the state. So the left hand is your social welfare wing of the state. And the right hand, I add, and this is the book Punishing the Poor. Punishing the Poor, this is volume 2, analyzes the rise, the invention of a new policy contraption to regulate poverty and inequality and to contain the disorders created by the rise of advanced marginality and to compensate for the lack of legitimacy that political elites suffer whenever they curtail the traditional protective missions of the state on the social and economic front. So what we see there is we see a double turn, I mean, a double pivoting of the state. There's a pivoting on the welfare side, and there's a pivoting on the penal side. And this is what I add to Bourdieu's model of the right hand of the state. I say, wait, the right hand of the state is not just the Ministry of the Treasury and the Ministry of Finance or the economy. It is very crucially, of course, typically it's the Interior Ministry that handles what? The police, the criminal justice, the police, the courts, and the prison. And so what we are witnessing in that period, alongside and in reaction to the rise of advanced marginality, we see the state effecting both two things. A punitive turn within each of these domains of state action. And here on the social welfare front, this takes the shift from welfare to workfare. And again, these two terms standing from welfare as a right to protection from the sanction of the labor market as a universal right granted categorically to all citizens by the mere fact that they are a member of the society or a resident of the society, to workfare as a duty, workfare as an obligation, that if you want to receive state support, now you have a series of obligations, behavioral obligations, that typically and crucially involve orienting yourself to the labor market and accepting low-wage employment as a condition of receiving state support and social protection. So social protection that used to be granted universally, unconditionally, is now granted, yes, but as a disciplinary device, as a springboard, not as a safety net and as a little igloo under which you can sort of come and seek protection from the economic cold, but rather as a springboard, as a trampoline that will equip and push people into the low wage labor market. So this is, you know, and this is a movement again that definitely on some, in Western Europe it's called, you know, active labor market policies. It's presented as a, you know, the positive light. It's now we're going to help you, we're going to, you know, train you, we're going to activate you, we're going to help you overcome the obstacles that you've encountered in finding employment. You know, as if the problem was with the, you know, the unemployed and not with the transmission of the world of labor. And on the penal side, on the side of criminal justice, essentially the shift from a rehabilitative and relatively limited criminal justice sector to an expensive, costly criminal justice system that no longer seeks to reform people and transform them and better them and lower their likelihood to commit crime, but rather to a retributive and neutralizing agency. And again, you know, this happens, you know, most Western European societies have kept the official belief in rehabilitation, but in reality their prison system have been transformed into de facto neutralizing agencies. Why? Because typically of overcrowding, of the lack of means of the criminal justice system to provide any of the services that on paper they're supposed to provide. And so what we see there, you know, we have a shift to, in a sense, punitive justice, punitive criminal justice and disciplinary social policy. And essentially punishing the poor argues that this is a reaction not this, so this shift, and this is the beginning of the building of the neoliberal state. Essentially what I argue is that what emerges is that the workfare and what I call prison fare, by analogy with workfare, prison fare is in a sense the deployment of the police, the courts, and the prison system to respond to the conditions of urban marginality and to treat the urban ills created by the routinization and the normalization of insecure wage labor at the bottom of the class structure, and you know, and the articulation of these stigma of place that reinforces the discriminatory behavior to the residents of the declining neighborhoods and sort of entrenches and reproduces this condition of advanced marginality. What we see is then is the convergence of social welfare, workfare, and prison fare become, in a sense, if you wish, objectively coordinated, and they come to create a single, tendentially, of course, again, you know, and with resistance on both sides, and with people on the social welfare wing refusing to serve as a disciplinary arm and trying to maintain the traditional protective missions of the social welfare, people in the criminal justice end trying to prevent the growing, you know, managerial and pornographic transformation of criminal justice, but, you know, but tendentially, increasingly, these come to form a single contraption that is used to effect the new regulation of poverty under this neoliberal regime. And a way to summarize this is to say that many of you will be familiar with the classic book by Francis Fox Piven and Richard Cloward, Regulating the Poor, published in 1973. It's 1971, you know, a classic of social science that argues that essentially welfare expands and contracts in keeping with the cycles of the economy. When the economy goes down and unemployment goes up, the threat of civil disorder rises and poverty rises. The state expands the social safety net in order to tamp down civil disorder and to remedy the most acute poverty. When the economy picks up and the labor market tightens, then you must push people into the labor market so that welfare contracts so that people will take the jobs that now become available and will no longer receive income support from the state. And I argue that this model works very well for the period 1880-1980, roughly, in a sense. It corresponds to the Keynesian-Fordist regime. But it no longer works that way after the mid-70s or the 80s. Now, instead of a cyclical expansion and contraction of protective welfare, we see a shift from protective welfare to disciplinary workfare, and we see the growth and glorification of the penal wing of the state as the means of curbing the disorders that used to be handled through welfare, and as the means, again, very pivotally, but very crucially, as the theater, as the public theater on which politicians will reassert the authority and the sovereignty of the state, when the authority of the sovereignty of the state, when the authority of the state is disappearing, and when the sovereignty of the state is being eroded from below, in particular through, you know, urban turmoil and transformations and immigration streams, and from above by the flows of capital and by the greater political integration into a larger bloc, such as the European Union. And so, essentially, punishing the poor makes three arguments, and I have prepared a 20-page paper that I haven't yet gotten to the first page. and I think I'm not going to use much of what I prepared. Then that goes, you know, useless labor. But essentially, what I argue is that I make three core arguments in punishing the poor. And actually, let me give you the end of the triangle because you're probably worrying. So essentially, this is Urban Outcast. This is volume two, says, how was the state transformed? And so as you can see, this is transformation of state policies, which means the categories, the discourses used to justify, to talk about the state. It means also the actions of the state. It means, of course, a shift in personnel, a shift in budget. It means also, eventually, a shift in the very architecture of the state. And this is why I argue this transformation of the state, this re-engineering of the Leviathan, is not a response to rising criminal insecurity or rising crime. It's a response to rising social insecurity. And it is a much broader transformation than just poverty policy. It's really re-engineering the invention of the neoliberal Leviathan, which will be quite a different animal than the state as we used to know it in between 1880 and 1980. And now let me, so essentially punishing the poor stresses and mines that triangle, but also shows that it's very important that to the degree that you have, now let's bring in the third element of the triangle, ethno-racial division or ethno-national division. To the degree that you have a population that people think of this population in sharply divided categories, that this division is rigid, is highly visible, is highly salient, and that there's a lack of mutual identification between the categories, and in particular measurable, for instance, in the intermarriage rates or in the ability to cross these ethnic boundaries. You know, so of course, if you have a very rigid system, such as the ethno-racial categorization system of the United States, which is based not on phenotype, but on descent, where you know you are black not because of your skin color, you are black because you're the descendant of a person who was black before you. That is, who was brought to the U.S. territory under bondage. You know, you are dishonored by that initial condition, and that dishonor or that lesser honor will continue for generations on end. It doesn't matter how many times you intermarry, by virtue of the principle of hypodescent that assigns the children of mixed unions to the lower category. That is, it doesn't matter how many white ancestors you have, so long as you have a black ancestor, you remain black. So this is a very sharp division in the case of the United States because it is not porous. There is no possibility of crossing that boundary. And it's highly salient and it's inscribed in the objectivity of physical space in segregated neighborhoods. It's inscribed in the objectivity of separate organizations. You have the NAACP and the Urban League who cater to the needs of the black population. Then you have other organizations that cater to the needs of the other population. You have a state whose very structure is organized along, you know, or whose very structures is the legacy of this ethno-racial division. For instance, many people do not know that the very peculiar system under which Americans elect their president, the Electoral College, is issued out of a constitutional compromise to allow the South to continue to have slavery, even as the country proclaimed democracy. So here you have a sharp, impassable, highly salient, highly, in a sense, agreed upon ethno-racial boundary, and that is sharply marked both in the objectivity and this in the subjectivity of people's consciousness and categorization in everyday life. If you come to Western Europe in the different societies, in a sense, you can say you have a more variable form of ethno-racial or ethno-national classification, and depending on the society, and so on, it's sharper, it's more salient, and so on. So you can make this a variable, but to the degree that you have a salient, sharp, and consequential form of ethnic division, then your working class is weakened, and it's not able to resist to resist the punitive term on both the social welfare front and the penal front. But also, so it means that ethnic division is mediating this relationship between class transformation and state transformation, and to the degree that you also have a state that has been configured in accordance and in keeping and in sense in cahoots with that ethno-racial division, then of course it means that the state will be more likely to act towards this transformation in a racially, ethno-racially patterned way. For instance, if you have a more inclusive citizenship where you have the rights of citizenship effectively have become the rights of denizenship, that if you're a resident, essentially you have all the rights of a national, then it's this type of society where that ethno-racial, ethno-national division is muted. And if it's muted, it means that the state acts more towards everybody in the same way, which means that it's more difficult to roll out categorical disciplinary systems, both on the welfare and on the criminal justice side. But if you have a system where there's a sharp division between nationals and foreigners, or, you know, immigrants, you know, where it's very difficult for the immigrants to become nationals, even the same, you know, the system that Germany had until the 1990s, where even if you were born and raised in Germany, if your parents were not German, of German blood, then you will never become German, then it's easier for the states to roll out categorical systems that treat differently, you know, the Germans of Turkish origin and the Germans of German origin, and it's easier for the states to roll out punitive discipline policies, both on the left-hand and on the right-hand side of the state. So then it means that we now have to come to our third pole, and this is the topic of the third book. The third book, it is so important, it is so complicated, and it is so sort of, it has so many intricacies and sociologically interesting elements that it deserves its own investigation. So there's a little bit, there's one chapter of Punishing the Poor, chapter 7, that does deal with why is it that in the case of the United States, it's African Americans who are the primary, lower class African Americans, who are the primary target of the transmission of the state, both on the social welfare front and especially on the criminal justice front. Why is lower class African Americans, that is residents of the collapsing hyper ghetto, why have they become the primary clients who have literally provided millions of bodies for the overgrown, expensive, booming, monstrous criminal justice system that the United States has created during that period? And the argument there is that it is because it is the group that is situated at the bottom of the double hierarchy that I mentioned at the beginning. You remember the hierarchy of class and materiality is the group that's at the bottom, it's lower class, but it's also the group it is dishonored, that is in the out category, in the in and out division. So if you want to introduce another little diagram, you know, essentially we're looking at the state doesn't always behave on paper. A democratic state is a state that presents the same face to all of its citizens, irrespective of their class position and their ethnic membership. But in reality, what we observe that states behave quite differently to those at the top of the class order or those at the bottom of the class order. So this is your order of class materiality, and this is your order in the symbolic realm, this is your order of ethnicity or ethnic honor. And then you have those who are honored and those who are dishonored. Us and them. And what I argue is that when we go back to the history of the of penal institutions, the invention of the prison and the rolling out of the police and the uses of criminal courts, what we observe is that the penal state is always rolled out according to that diagonal. It always targets from this very origin. The prison was not invented, contrary to what many people think. It's a good lesson. It's always good to return to the initial invention of institutions, because oftentimes in the period of invention, you can see the actual purpose of the institution clearly. Then this purpose becomes overlaid with new discourses, with new transformations, with new justifications as experts grow and specialists grow inside the state that explain what they do and so on. And then later, decades or centuries later, there's a completely different justification for the activities of that institution. You go back to the origins in the 16th century, in the long 16th century, and you will discover that when the prison was invented, the Bridewell of London, l'Hôpital Général de Paris, the Zuchthaus of Amsterdam in the late 16th century, what you observe is that the prison wasn't invented to deal with crime, it was invented to deal with urban marginality. It was invented to resolve what was known then in London as the problem of the sturdy beggar. The sturdy beggar, meaning an able-bodied adult who is begging on the street, who should be working. But you know what? There isn't any work for them. Why? Because wage labor hasn't even been yet invented. But the feudal society has collapsed, and these people no longer have a position in the rural economy. So they're migrating into the cities. This is the first burst of commercial capitalist industrialization in Western Europe, in the cities of, you know, Northern Germany and then the Netherlands, you know, and England. It's the Manchester, the Bremen, and the Amsterdams of the world, and, you know, in Paris. So it's not by happenstance that you see the first prisons emerging, not to tackle crime, but to tackle the idleness of the new insecure, detached poor. So detached and disreputable, because if you were part of the local community, you had an attachment to a household or to a group, then you were protected from the intervention of the criminal justice system, because then you were disciplined by the traditional social control system of, you know, family and, you know, and neighborhood and guild and city authority. But if you were detached, you came from another village, from another city, you were suddenly found yourself in Bremen, you know, on the streets, then for you there was this new contraption that was invented, the prison, invented to manage urban marginality. And now note, importantly, so this is what I call the vector of penalization. It always goes from, you know, the authority is at the top left-hand side, among those of the upper class who are the ethnically honored or who are full members of the society. Indeed, they run the society, they are building the state. And they are building a state in the 16th century that invents this contraption that will target those who are at the bottom of the order of class and the order of honor, those who are detached, not us, not members of our community, and who are poor. And they are building a state and creating two inventions in the long 16th century. They are building, and it's not by happenstance, against my thesis, it's not by happenstance, this happens at the same time. The 16th century is also the period where the first poor laws are passed, and where there's a shift from religious and local forms of welfare and poor support to the emergence of essentially poor relief as an official institution, and in particular as a secular institution that is now going to be the responsibility of the state to provide some degree of, since the early version of welfare. And my argument is that it's not... Just as in the 16th century we've seen the concurrent invention of new forms of state activity, a new perimeter, new institutions of the state, providing poor relief and providing punishment for the disreputable detached poor, similarly in the late 20th century, early 21st century, we see the reinvention of a state that revamps both its social welfare policy and its criminal justice policy to retool itself to deal with the changing forms of urban marginality. So, in a sense, it is at the end of the 20th century, as in the end of the 16th century. What we're seeing there, 16th century, this is the birth of the early modern state. This is the beginnings of the invention of the Leviathan. Late 20th century, early 21st century, this is the beginnings of the invention of this new neoliberal Leviathan. That targets very actively those who are at the bottom of the double system of class hierarchy, materiality, and honor and dishonor in the symbolic realm. And so this takes us to this third book in the trilogy, and this is the book Deadly Symbiosis, Race and the Rise of the Penal State, which I apologize to all of you who have ordered the book since 2005 on Amazon. It's still not in print, because I withdrew it when I realized it was more complicated than I could explain in that version of the book. And then I realized that I needed actually to provide the full picture of advanced marginality. And then the initial transformation, the initial invention of the government of social insecurity, so that the reader would have an idea of what is the animal that is being chased, and it is being chased with what instrument, to understand fully how racial divisions impact the transformation of the state, how, to the degree that you have an ethnically, ethno-nationally, ethno-racially divided population, it facilitates, it accelerates, it intensifies, it lubricates the shift from protective welfare to punitive warfare, and it also lubricates, intensifies, expands, justifies the shift from sort of a moderately sized, rehabilitative criminal justice system to a punitive, neutralizing, retributive criminal justice system. And to the degree that, so it means in concrete terms, that in a given society, to the degree that you believe that your welfare recipients have a dark skin, or, you know, a different complexion, or a different cultural makeup that is inherently different that we can't really deal with. That is, to the degree, in the case of African America, in the case of the United States, it means to the degree that you believe that welfare recipients are essentially, you know, immoral black women who have babies out of wedlock because they can't control their sexuality, which is a dominant, very prevalent, you know, image, even though most welfare recipients are whites. The image, you know, is that this is a young teenage, and there's even the expression that sadly sociologists have taken over and have used. I mean, it's shocking because it's a term of abuse. It's the term welfare mother. How, you know, how as a sociologist can you, I mean, how, you know, unconscious can you be of your duty to be a rigorous analyst of the social world, that you are taking over a folk category that serves as a terms of a term of abuse to designate and to castigate a particular subsector of the population? You should be analyzing the process whereby the category of welfare mother is invented, and not use that as your analytic category, because nobody talks about stock market divorcees. You know, in the case of men who are very wealthy and who are divorced, you know, who are not taking care of their children and yet are making tons of money on the stock market. You know, in fact, you laughed when I said stock market divorcee, but you didn't laugh when I said welfare mother. You know, which shows that even in Sweden, in a sense, there is this sort of, you know, this category that somehow I see that you believe your welfare recipients are the social consciousness. People who are inherently different from you and me, then it is not only easier, it is politically profitable for state managers to propose policies that will target these groups and target to discipline them rather than to protect and help them, that make these groups part of the problem and not, you know, in a sense, the victims or the ones who have to suffer from this overall transformation. To the degree that you believe that your criminals are persons who come from the outside, persons who are different from you and me, phenotypically, culturally, then it's also easier to roll out particular policies. Yes, 2 days ago, the Minister of the Interior of Nicolas Sarkozy, the sinister géant, made his annual presentation. Oh, this is interesting because it brings us back to the penal state. He made his annual presentation of the official figures of criminality and of crime trends, which have become a political show. You know, it didn't used to happen. I mean, 20 years ago, no Minister of the Interior in continental Europe would present, you know, would make a TV show with a special press conference with graphs and, you know, and video and so on and so forth to present the annual figure of crime. Why has this happened? It has happened because now presenting the action of the state on the law and order front has become a major element of political theater, a way of asserting the authority of the state. And yesterday, 2 days ago, was the last time that Sarkozy's Minister of the Interior has presented these figures. They were not very good. In particular, there's a very significant increase in burglary. And so the explanation was that this anomalous development, we were in. So the official line was that crime has decreased for the seventh year in a row, decreased by 0.01%. And it's decreased only because they massage the numbers so that they change the statistic every year so that they can show that crime is going down, which means what? That the state is acting. The state is active. The state is tamping its authority on the ground, at ground level. It's really tamping down. It hasn't exactly tamped down a white-collar crime and corporate crime, particularly financial crime, that led the whole world economy to go into the ditch in 2008. But it's handling street crime. Proof, we have the statistics. Let us make a show that essentially is showing the sovereign state, the sovereign neoliberal Leviathan in action. So here his show was disrupted by the fact that he had to explain this anomaly of the 15% rise in burglary. And the explanation was, it's a brand new phenomenon that has emerged this year, that is due to the intrusion of organized gangs coming from Eastern Europe, who somehow travel all the way to the small cities of rural France to burglarize people. I mean, this is one of the top officials of the French government is serving you this ridiculous tale. You know, that who is it? It's the foreigners, it's them, it's, you know. And then, of course, immediately announced a whole series of special measures that we're going to cooperate with Romanian and Bulgarian police, and we're going to have these special measures that will allow us to deport them quicker. Essentially, we're going to breach their rights as European citizens so that we can handle them quickly and so that we can get rid of the problem that is created by them, the outsiders. Those
at the bottom of the double hierarchy of class and honor, and this serves to reaffirm the authority and the capacity of the state to act. So in this third volume, I do two things, and since you can say, well, in a diagram like this, you have a double relationship. You have to understand how racial division impacts, facilitates, intensifies the punitive shift on the social welfare and the criminal justice front, and the meshing of those two elements of the double regulation of advanced marginality in the society of social insecurity. But then the more tricky part is to understand how the transmission of the state in turn remakes race, remakes ethnicity, remakes ethno-national and ethno-racial division. And here the connection is, it's a deeper connection. There's a much deeper connection between penality, which is the set of categories of institutions and practices and representations that have to do with punishment. There's a much deeper relationship between penality and race. Race is essentially than meets the eye. In particular, it's not simply due to the fact that there's supposedly a higher crime rate, this is a vulnerable population and so on. But essentially, race is a particular subtype of ethnicity that I call denigrated ethnicity. It's a form of ethnicity that is a cultural and historical division based on relations of honor that portrays itself as not ethnic. It portrays itself as rooted in biology, as rooted in the necessities of biology rather than the accidents of history and culture. And so it's a form of ethnicity that tells you, I'm not ethnic. So it's denigrated ethnicity. It's a subtype of ethnicity that is bizarre for that. And so it's particularly difficult to understand, and I think the social sciences have done themselves a great disservice when they've introduced this inane, completely illogical division between race and ethnicity. Because you don't need a concept of race and ethnicity. The second you introduce the division between race and ethnicity, you're saying race is sociologically, constitutively something different from ethnicity. We need one framework to understand one, another framework to understand the other. You are participating into the collective belief that race actually exists and is this fundamentally different entity than ethnicity or nation or religion or linguistic based differences, and you're actually reproducing, entrenching the very phenomenon you should be analyzing. Thus, and the inane division between race and ethnicity in your own courses, in your own writing, in your own thinking, and understand race as a subtype of ethnicity that is highly peculiar because it pretends not to be ethnic. It is denigrated ethnicity, but essentially race is a form of ethnicity that entails dishonor, that entails a blemish, that entails, you know, a discrediting. Those who are in that category are constitutively and a priori believed to be somehow lacking, inferior, you know, not part of us. And what is penality? Penality is that form of branding that the state uses to inflict dishonor on the citizens, on the members of the collectivity who have violated a core rule and therefore are sanctioned by the criminal justice system and are set aside either for a while or forever and deemed, in a sense, lesser beings, lesser citizens. So penality is a form of state-mandated dishonor. And race is, if you wish, a sort of society, an outgrowth of social processes of establishing dishonor. And so in Weberian terms, a sort of an elective affinity with racialization and penalization. That is a deep one because both are institutions premised on dishonoring those who are racialized, dishonoring those who are punished. So this is essentially the third element of the trilogy, and like how am I going to wrap this up so that it makes it interesting? One last argument. Then, in a sense, having resolved or having set this agenda and having provided, so here I provided, you know, a set of concepts to try to understand what is going on. I put forth the notion of advanced marginality, and I try to characterize this regime. I explicate what a ghetto is, and this is the book, The Two Faces of the Ghetto, that for those of you, since Nordic people read German very often, at least scholars, you can read it. It's a beautifully titled book in German. You can have this, unfortunately, in the English language version, it doesn't have this beautiful ring. It's Das Janusgesicht des Ghettos. You know, the two faces, the Janus-faced institution of the ghetto. You know, and so it's an effort to characterize what a ghetto is. A ghetto is a contraption of ethno-racial closure. It's a spatially based way of
compressing and containing a desired category, bringing that category into the city so that you can extract economic value out of it, and yet keeping it ostracized, keeping it at a social distance. And so the ghetto has this contraption that allows for the economic extraction and social ostracization of a stigmatized category, is a very distinct social formation. When it collapses, it leads on the one side to the hyper-ghetto, and in the case of the working class territory, I forged the concept of anti-ghetto to show how these working class territories are evolving in a direction opposite to that of the ghetto. There are neighborhoods that are becoming more ethnically heterogeneous, not more ethnically homogeneous. Foreigners in Western Europe are becoming more dispersed throughout the national territory, including in Sweden, including in Gothenburg. In fact, there's a terrific thesis and paper by Åsa Bromo. It reads Brahma to us, but I understand that it's pronounced Bromo if I don't butcher her name. She's a young geographer who has done a fabulous study of Gothenburg, of the belief that there's a rise of these highly segregated ghettoized areas. In reality, what you have is areas that are intensely multi-ethnic and that are becoming more ethnically heterogeneous, and foreigners and immigrants overall are becoming more dispersed in Gothenburg and more dispersed in Swedish society as a whole. These neighborhoods also are not becoming the incubators of more organizations for the group and by the group. They are being emptied of their organizations. These neighborhoods don't have impassable boundaries. On the contrary, those who succeed and rise in the class structure, whatever their ethnicity, leave the neighborhood immediately. And these neighborhoods fail to produce a collective identity. In each of these five respects, they are antinomic to a ghetto, because when a neighborhood becomes ghettoized, it becomes more ethnically homogeneous, it corrals more and more of the members of the particular category that's being ghettoized. In the neighborhood, the group that is corralled there will create more and more organizations, so you will see a rise in organizational density. The boundaries of the neighborhood become impassable, and because they are corralled in this neighborhood and have their own organizations, the population stigmatized and ghettoized will then produce a collective identity. And what we're seeing in Western Europe is exactly the opposite. That's why I call these neighborhoods that are becoming pauperized and stigmatized anti-ghetto. So I forge this concept of advanced marginality, ghetto, hyper-ghetto, anti-ghetto. Here I introduce, the notion of prison fare, and I show how penalization is a response to social insecurity, not criminal insecurity. I show that we need to think of social welfare and criminal justice policy as two variants of poverty policy. Why? Because historically they were invented together for the same purpose, because they target the same population, and because increasingly they use the same techniques. And so if I have a message from people in the room who study social welfare, who typically don't talk to people who study crime and punishment, and a message to people who study crime and punishment, who typically don't talk to their colleagues who study social welfare, I'd say, people who study welfare and people who study criminal justice, unite. You have nothing to lose but your intellectual chains. And you will gain enormous analytic and empirical mileage when you realize that in the same household where the women receive welfare, it is the man of these women, that it is the boyfriend, it is the son, it is the brother of these women, who are also the ones who are involved with the police and who end up, being caught by the courts and sometimes, being sent to prison. And the third element is what I will close with, is, if I could turn this, can I turn this blackboard? Yes. Oh, maybe not. Maybe in the abstract I can, but I'll try to draw the little diagram on the side. Because I want to keep these for the questions. If
it's
not, on the back side as well.
No. It's wings.
Here we go. Now I come to the conclusion, which is this leads me to sort of put forward, somewhat gingerly, because I don't think I don't think I'm that good of a political sociologist, and I think I'm sort of stepping beyond where I feel confident that I can affirm this, but this leads me to put forth a sociological characterization of neoliberalism. And in particular, to make, first of all, the argument that neoliberalism is not an economic project, it is a political project. It is a project of state transformation. For a very simple reason, is that markets are not self-defined, self-propelled, self-generating entities. Markets everywhere are the creatures of state. Markets are price-based systems of exchange that exist only because a state is there to guarantee property, to set up legal rules for exchange and to enforce rules of accounting, of so on and so forth, and to regularize exchange. So markets are always everywhere political creations. That's the number one element. But also because the coming of market is not that much of a novel phenomenon. You know, there's always been, especially since the 16th century, you know, there's the efforts to create market and market-like mechanisms. What is new is the use of the state to impose the market form everywhere, and the use of the state to impose the market form and to stamp it onto citizenship. And so that first proposition I would put forth is that neoliberalism is not an economic regime, it's a political project of re-engineering the state. And this re-engineering of the state has not one element, but four elements. Typically, when people, you know, and again, neoliberalism is this mongrel, slippery, sulfurous notion. You know, it's sort of uneasily suspended between a category of ordinary discourse and social criticism and journalism and public debate and an analytic category. Many scholars are sort of leery of using neoliberalism as a category other than to describe that people believe there is something called neoliberalism. Many economists, paradoxically, I was just in communication with Bruno Amable, who is one of France's top economists, and asking him, could you direct me to the latest writings of economists on neoliberalism? And his response was that, well, economists just don't like to talk about neoliberalism. You know, it's a little dirty word. You know, even though they are the ones who have theorized and permitted its rise, you know, they like to talk about the market and they like to talk about deregulation and so on, but they don't like to talk about neoliberalism too much. But I think it's a sort of, you know, suspended between an ideological category and an analytic category. And what I propose to try to do now in the 3 minutes or 5 minutes I'm going to use is to forge, and this is what I do in the concluding chapter of Punishing the Poor and in a series of papers that you can find on my webpage. One of them is called Crafting the Neoliberal State. The other one is called Three Steps Towards a Historical Anthropology of Actually Existing Neoliberalism. I propose to craft a sociological concept of neoliberalism that breaks with the ordinary folk, semi-journalistic, commonsensical notion, which is essentially an economic notion or an economistic notion. Typically under neoliberalism, people put, you know, the coming rule of the market. It's what I call the market rule model. And then that's it. It's the coming of the market. It's the rule of the market. It means less state. It means withdrawing the state. It means, you know, cutting public budgets, lowering taxes, facilitating the flow of capital, deregulating labor markets. So in a sense, it's the withdrawal, the retraction of the state and the rule of markets. And I would argue that, you know, that's interesting, but that's the ideology of neoliberalism. Actually existing neoliberalism doesn't work that way. When that discourse or when that program is implemented, so what we can call commodification, generically, that is a transformation of everything into a merchandise, into a commodity that will impose market, or I prefer the expression market-like mechanisms, because many suppose markets, like for instance the financial market, is not a market as neoclassical theory, you know, proposes. Because there are plenty of barriers to entry, because it's the government that sets the rule of what you can, whether you can, you know, sell certain kinds of, you know, derivatives, or you can, how you have to sell them, what information you have to provide, and so on. Many of these so-called markets wouldn't exist if the state wasn't there to authorize them, to regularize them, and so forth. And they really don't obey, you know, the new entrants on the market can't just come like this. You have to be authorized, you have to be, you know, an official player, and so on. So they're really more market-like mechanisms than market mechanisms. But essentially, the first element of neoliberalism is this thrusting market or market-like mechanisms on all human activities, not just economic activities, but on welfare, on education, on the provision of childcare, on the provision of, you know, on retirement, on everything. And typically people stop there. And I would say, yes, that's good, it's a good start, but it's a little thin. It's a little thin. This is an economic ideology of neoliberalism. When we stay there, we are right, just like when people say race and ethnicity, they are inside the ideology of race. I think when people say this is neoliberalism, they are inside the ideology of neoliberalism. And they are, in a sense, participating into the diffusion of that revolutionary project of a revolution from above. Then what we observe is that everywhere where, and this means not deregulation, but rather re-regulation in favor of firms.
particularly in favor of large firms, particularly in favor of multinational firms, particularly in favor of firms that have liquid assets and so on and so forth. But you know, we don't need to go into this detail. What's very important is that everywhere where government has pursued these policies of re-regulation in favor of firms, and in a sense, you sort of, you know, not the shift to liquid modernity of Zygmunt Bauman, but the shift to the liquid economy, essentially what they've had to do is they've had to deal with, they've had, particularly in the labor market, they've had to force those who historically wouldn't take those jobs to take the jobs of the deregulated labor, new wage labor market. And it means that you've had a shift from welfare to workfare. And the shift from welfare to workfare is not a shrinking of the state, it's a revamping of the modality under which the state regulates the poor. In fact, in many ways, it's much more intrusive, and it's much more supervisory, it's much more dictating than traditional welfare. So you've had, in a sense, you have had the revamping of social welfare policy with the shift from welfare to workfare, and I argue that's a constitutive element of neoliberalism, of the neoliberal state, but you've had also to deal with now with the sort of social consequences of the turmoil, the disorders created in the lower class district, in the redoubts of advanced urban marginality, and so it means that prison fare, or an expensive, and expensive with an A, expensive with an E, you know, penal state, penal wing of the state, which means the glorification, the growth, and the rolling out of the police, the courts, and the prison system, is not a side show, it's not an accident, it's not a deviation from neoliberalism, it's not a teratological development, it is a building block of the neoliberal state. And indeed we observe that all the societies, and the more the society course and thrust and move forward on that first element of neoliberalism, the commodification and the market-like organization of all human activities, and the more they push their revamping of social welfare policy in the workfare, in the disciplinary mode, and the more they develop their penal state. It's not by happenstance, it's Chile, which was the first incubator, the first sort of experiment, grand experiment in neoliberal restructuring, was also very early the penal leader of Latin America, and is to this day the society of Latin America that incarcerates the most. It's not by happenstance that England, which in the European Union has been at the vanguard of deregulating the labor market and commodifying and privatizing most activities of the state, is also the society that copied, lock, stock and barrel, Xeroxed the American model of the shift from welfare to workfare, imported it, exactly, and also imported zero tolerance policing, and it's also, up until the late 1990s, was the leader in incarceration in Western Europe. And lastly, the fourth element is the trope of individual responsibility. Individual responsibility, which serves as the cultural glue that will assemble these different elements, and you note how individual responsibility also is in an affinity with the rolling out of the penal wing of the state, because of course everywhere penal codes, insofar as they're based on Roman law, penal codes are premised on the notion of personal responsibility. You cannot have collective culpability or collective responsibility. You can only have individual responsibility. And so what we end up having in the end is a system, and I'll close with that, that has the distribution, the state comes, and then this leads later on. So this is essentially my neoliberalism is not a, you know, is not a an animal that has one leg, nor is it like the Foucauldian Stellas with their model of governmentality, a million little technologies of government that are diffused everywhere, like a, I don't know how you call this animal in English, the milpat. It's a little insect that has 1,000 legs. So you can find the Swedish equivalent. So neoliberalism is neither a one-leg animal nor this thousand-leg little insect that's going everywhere. It is a quadruped. It is an institutional quadruped that walks on these four legs. And everywhere, I argue, or at least you can use the framework to then compare the evolution of the Swedish state, the evolution of the German state, the evolution of the South African state, the evolution of the Argentine state, the evolution of the United States, federal, local, state, and city government. You can use this framework to see to what degree do we see these four elements arising, and to what degree are they forming the building blocks of the neoliberal Leviathan that work together and that constitute a coherent ensemble for the new regulation of
advanced marginality at the bottom, expanding social inequality in the middle, assuaging, now note, and maybe I'll close with that and I'll skip that, this is, gets too complicated, although it's jazzy, it's my preferred part that I prefer, so I'm going to be tempted to still stick it in, maybe in the discussion. But note how, for instance, I mentioned, remember that in contemporary society, a society of advanced social insecurity and of resurging inequality, that the middle class is very anxious. It's very anxious of falling down, of being downwardly mobile. If you lose your job, maybe your wife will leave you. If your wife you lose your housing. If you lose your housing, you'll find yourself on the streets. Now, a remarkable statistic. In French society, 85% of the French, according to a recent poll, fear becoming homeless. Now, this is a grotesque statistic because, you know, the objective probability that they become homeless is probably of the order of 0.001%. I mean, it's, you know, it's the homeless population, as large as it has grown, it's still a tiny population, and it's essentially recruited from the very, very bottom, the more marginal sectors of the working class. And yet, the fear of becoming homeless is widespread. The fear, because in a sense, the homeless has become the physical embodiment of the fear of downward mobility and the social fall. And, you know, and so the middle class is greatly anxious. And it's also anxious about family forms. It's anxious about maybe one of its kids, you know, coming home and, you know, and making their coming out and saying that they participate into an alternative form of sexuality or they're going to marry. And so you have this anxiety over sexuality, this anxiety over family, this anxiety over the age-graded relationships that are coming apart, this anxiety about social fall and the fear of both falling yourself or not being able to transmit your status to your children, which is one of the big emotional, libidinal drivers of middle-class life is not the satisfaction of your social status, it's the satisfaction that your children will do better and that if you sacrifice, but at least they will have what you didn't have. Well, now, what if you sacrifice and they don't have what you didn't have? Then where does the libidinal energy come from? So this whole, in a sense, this ball of social anxiety with multiple sources and multiple origins then becomes rolled into one and targeted towards whom? Towards the immigrants, towards the derelict, towards the streets, you know, the street thugs, towards the criminals, and then the states, various state agents, very, very shrewdly sort of use the theater of law and order, use the restoring of the policing and harsh criminal justice, and they use and they deploy what I call pornographic penalty. Penal measures that are not done, not because they are rational, because they're going to have an impact in crime, but because they allow politicians to be seen as acting, to be in action, to be doing something about the problem. And so this anxiety, this social anxiety coursing through the social body can get captured and channeled and directed to those who are, you know, the unworthy cheating welfare recipient, the Romanian immigrant who comes and who doesn't have a place in the society, is there, you know, as in a sense, either as a parasite or as a threat or even as social vermin. You know, and I use the term advisedly because this was the term that was used by Mayor Giuliani to describe the homeless in his own city in the 1990s when he devised and helped proselytize for the policy of zero tolerance. He would describe the homeless as social vermin that needs essentially to be exterminated and to be swept aside. And so the penalty, the expanding, you know, and rolling out in a spectacular way the penal wing of the state, essentially since it is a penal wing that is highly targeted, you know. It allows state agents to essentially fix that social anxiety, and then bridge the deficit of legitimacy that they experience when they essentially say the state can no longer protect you, the state cannot be there on the social front, the state cannot be there on the economic front, but you know what, the state will be there on the law and order front, the state will clean the streets, the state will maintain that boundary of honor between us and them. And if he doesn't protect you from falling down in the class order, at least he will ensure that those who are on the other side of the ethnic division will not come and intrude and take the one last thing that you have, which is your membership into this hallowed, gloried ethnic community or national community. So in a sense, the state is playing on the fear of that the middle class generically has of becoming the poor whites in their own country. You know, and then rolls out, and then this triple transformation of the state economic re-regulation in favor of firms, social welfare to social workfare, disciplining, and penal expansion and penal glorification, and the trope of individual responsibility are the building blocks of the making of the neoliberal Leviathan, which is arising at the beginning of the 21st century, just as the early modern state arose in Western Europe in the early 16th century. Thank you.
Oh.
Thank you very much. And now it's time for questions and comments. So if there are, there are maybe many.
I hope there
we
are.
We have 20 minutes. Okay, we start with you with the blonde hair there.
You need a microphone.
Yeah. I hope you have questions because that's why I came.
Hello. I have a question, and it might be really silly, but I just didn't get it. When was there ever social welfare as a universal good? When was the social protection as you talked about? Because I do not find it in my historical awareness anywhere.
Okay. Quick response, everything is relative. If you compare the conditions of the working class in 1950 or 1960 compared to the working class of 1930 or 1870, you will find there's a variety of goods to which everybody has access, or the marginal sections of the working class do have access: public housing, public education, social welfare support in case of extreme destitution, child allowances, retirement, which is not, contrary to what people believe, retirement is not a social insurance system where you pay into the system and you get back what you put in. It is a de facto redistribution, not only across generation but through fiscal means. And so, yes, I thank you for your question, that I don't want to idealize the age of 1880 to 1980, and I don't want to make it seem like the welfare state of old used to be this generous, but it remains that most of the social rights were granted uniformly, typically to everybody as a citizen. Let me take an example. Throughout Western Europe, one of the most enduring policies has been family policies, an allowance that is given to all families that have children, irrespective of their job status, irrespective. In fact, it's given to wealthy households as well as given to poor households. Let me give you a second example. So there's family allowance. The second is also fiscal benefits tied to having children. Typically in 50, at least 15, if not 20 of the 27 countries of the European Union, if you have children, you get a fiscal benefit. Actually, a fiscal benefit that typically benefits more those at the top than those at the bottom, given that in many countries, the bottom half of the population doesn't pay the income tax, they don't get any income benefit. But it is granted universally to you if you fit in a particular category, and many of these rights are granted to you universally as a member of that collectivity, including the fact that by the 1970s and 1980s, many of these rights are not only granted to nationals, that is to citizens, but are really granted to denizens. That is, if you're a legal permanent resident of a particular country, many of these rights will be extended to you. For instance, the right of access to public education, free and public education. You know, if you are even if you are an illegal foreigner in many societies, you cannot be denied access. In many societies, you cannot be denied access to healthcare. So they was during this era, the building, and again, it's not something that arises one time that is universal, that is perfect everywhere. No, it's a result of struggles. It's a result of battles, and it's imperfect, and it depends. And so some societies have rights that are more generous, that are more universal, or they are universal on paper, but they are not delivered universally, and you have to have struggles to essentially have the state act in accordance to its own principles and to its own laws. But eventually, in this period, this long century, what you see is the growth of these rights, the extension of these rights, the fact that they are more and more, they tend to be universal. If they are categorical, they cover broad categories. And in particular, they are not conditional on behavior, the particular behavior
that you engage in. And then what you begin to see in the late 70s and 80s and accelerating into the 90s, you begin to see that many of these rights become eroded, many of these rights are eliminated, or many of these rights become conditional. That is, you will have them, yes, but only if you fulfill this and that particular category, and only typically behavioral categories that entail the behavior, your behavior, and sometimes the behavior of your children. For instance, in France, there's been a series of propositions to say to reduce family allowances given to families if their children don't go to school regularly, or if their children become juvenile delinquent and they commit more than 3 offenses, then the family will be sanctioned and will see its family allowance cut in half, or cut by 1/3, or cut by 10%, whatever. Which means that you used to have a universal right given to all people who have children. If you fit in that category, universally you will receive it. Now you will not universally receive it. You will receive it conditional on your children behaving according to the dictates of the official institutions and so on. So I think that, you know, I agree with you. I don't want to idealize the... You know, sometimes people say, oh, but you really think this was the golden age, you know, 40s, and you want the return to the 40s Keynesian age. No, I want, you know, I advocate no return. We don't, you know, history is not... We don't want to go back in history. But if you compare, particularly if you compare the 19th century to that long 20th century, then you see this unification, this growth of rights, this extension of the social safety net, and this increased role of the state as a protector against the sanction of the labor market. And starting in the mid-70s, you see, in a sense, a reversal. But it's a reversal, it's important, it's a reversal. That's not a return to the state of the 19th century. Because the state of the 19th century didn't have workfare. It didn't have prison fare. It didn't proselytize with the discourse of individual responsibility. And more importantly, it didn't have the administrative means to really penetrate social space and to reach into working class households. Yes, I understand that social historians who work on social welfare and so on will tell you, oh yes, they did, but either the social welfare or the criminal justice apparatus only really penetrated a very small number of households. It didn't really have much of an overall aggregate impact, simply because the state didn't have the administrative, technical, and manpower capacity. Contemporary states do have this capacity, particularly, you know, with the growth of digital databases and distant surveillance and so on and so forth. Now you can be, if you're a household that receives some, in fact, I was told repeatedly by my colleagues, if I want to do an analysis of this, please tell us, we'll run whatever data tables you need, because we have fabulous data where we can follow the residents of poor neighborhoods of Sweden everywhere, even when they have left, even 10 years later. We have 20 years of data on their household, on their behavior, with very detailed data on individuals, which attests to the capacity of the state to penetrate, to surveil, to keep tabs, to have files on its citizens. Now, if you have files and you know what is going on, you know where they are, and you know what they do, then you have the ability to intervene. If you compare that to the 19th century, it's night and day. You know, in the 19th century, essentially, you could disappear. You move from to a different city. People wouldn't find you for a long time. If the state wanted to come and surveil what you were doing, it was so easy to get away. The state didn't have the means to do that. So it's not the return. It's very important to understand that. That's an aside. I use your question to put forth another point. This is not a return. It's very important. It is not the return to the 19th century watchman state. And this is what the ideology of neoliberalism has been. The ideology of neoliberalism is that we withdraw the state and the market will fill up, and then civil society will also take care of the problems that the state used to handle. This is the traditional Manchester-style watchman state of the 19th century. This is not what is happening at all. What we're seeing is the building of a strong state, of a supervisory state, of an interventionist state. Only its modality of intervention, the purpose for which it intervenes, the ways in which it intervenes, the population that it targets is different than all of that during the Keynesian 40 stage.
There
are some more questions. I was just wondering where was this welfare?
In Sweden.
In Sweden.
Yes, okay. In Sweden. I'll give you some readings on the Swedish welfare state. And its effect on reducing inequality and on stamping down poverty, on eliminating child poverty. The Nordic countries are among the countries that have virtually eliminated child poverty during the 1980s and 1990s. When you compare the level of poverty, particularly for children, for the elderly, when you compare income inequality, when you compare life expectancy, when you compare the provision of housing, you will see that the Nordic welfare state, of which the Swedish instantiation is one example, was tremendously successful in reducing inequality, in providing, you know, for the needs of the destitute, and in lengthening the life expectancy, and in providing housing and healthcare and so on and so forth. It may not be to your full satisfaction, But by historical standards, it was much better living, it is still much better living in Sweden than it is living in the United States, or, you know, or living in South Africa, or living in Sweden of the 1930s, or in France of the 1950s.
Thank you for your lecture. I really agree that it's a time for painting the big picture again. Maybe it always is, but and I really appreciate your attempt to formulate a sociological theory of neoliberalism. But there's one thing that is missing in that picture, I think, and it's structural conflicts and collective agency. Because now in your response to the question, you said the welfare state emerged as a result of collective struggles. So then I would like to ask you, in your big picture, where do you see the structurally significant sites for social conflict and collective agency?
Thank you very much. You saved me from one grievous error. I knew there was something missing from my presentation. And it is one key concept that I use to understand the remaking of the state. And I'll go back to here because I have some room here to write. I have become a one-man campaign, a one-man global campaign to proselytize and to promote the notion of bureaucratic field. It's Bourdieu's concept of bureaucratic field. Bourdieu gives us three concepts to think: power and the state, and so on and so on. He gives us the notion of political field, the set of institutions in which agents vie to seize the levers of political decision-making, and typically it involves the parliament, trade unions, associations, and, you know, so and then part of the elective functions in government. So you have political field, you have the notion, the very complicated, and then you have the complicated notion of field of power, which is the those fields in which the concentrations of the different forms of power vie for the relative weight of religious power versus secular power, of scientific power versus juridical power versus economic power, and so on and so forth. And then you have, very crucially, the notion of bureaucratic field. The notion of bureaucratic field through which Bourdieu proposes to rethink the state. And the bureaucratic field is that set of agencies that successfully claims a monopoly over the definition and the provision of public goods. And if it is a field, in the Bourdieuian sense of the term, it means that it is two things. It is a field of forces, like a magnetic field, in which when agents enter and they want to do things, they are subjected to objective forces, and irrespective of their will. If you enter into the bureaucratic field of Sweden today, you find a state that's already constituted, that has a very powerful social wing, that has, you know, a relatively limited penal wing, that has, you know, a whole series of properties, and then your actions are limited because you are in this magnetic field. But also, and very importantly, a field for Bourdieu is not only a magnetic field, it is also a battlefield. It is a terrain of struggles. And the state is historically the result, what we call the state. So with the notion of bureaucratic field, Bourdieu proposes that we, instead of think of the state as a unity, as a monolith, as a coherent, you know, actor that can be seized by forces outside or that can be subordinated by the forces of capital, that we think of the state as a terrain of struggle, as itself differentiated, as itself splintered, as itself so the state is the result of historical struggle. The particular state that you get, the social democratic, the liberal, the conservative, Catholic state, are the result of the historical trajectory of struggles between unions and, you know, women's group and, you know, and immigrant rights group and lawyers and, you know, people both inside and outside the state. So the state is the result of struggle. It is the terrain of struggle, both by actors who are outside the state, and this is classical social movement theory and political sociology, but what is too often forgotten, of struggles going on inside the states, very crucially. And many of the transmissions of the state of the last 20 years haven't been the result of struggles from agents coming from outside the state towards the state. They've been the result, that's the thesis that I put forth, they've been the result of struggles internal to the state. Struggles between the left hand and the right hand in particular, that has led to the shifting of resources and personnel and population and responsibilities from the right hand to the left hand, but has also led to the colonization of the left hand by techniques and goals and technologies from the right hand. And so the state is both the result of struggle, it is the terrain of struggle, it is an agent in those struggles, because elements of the state, for instance the criminal justice system, will act, will claim responsibility for a particular problem, will battle against others, so it is an agent, and it is a stake in struggles. So if there's something that is absolutely epicentral to that model, then I, and so what I in what I do in Punishing the Poor, and I forgot to say that, and I thank you for giving me a chance to say it, is that I adopt Bourdieu's notion of bureaucratic field, and I use it in particular to bring into a single framework social welfare transformation and penal transformation. And I show how there were struggles at both ends of the bureaucratic field. In the social welfare wing, there were struggles. There were lots of resistance, and you know, by traditional social workers and traditional who said, "No, we don't want to be there to push people into the labor market." You know, and social workers everywhere across the Western world actually bemoan their role, that now they feel they have become policemen. They feel they have become there to discipline people, that they don't have the means, that they don't have, that they have too many cases to take, and that not only that, but they really have to push people to do things that they shouldn't be doing. And so you have struggles going on. You have struggles in the right-hand side of the state. You have struggles inside the criminal justice apparatus. For instance, I'll give you just a quick example. In Austria, that make this project derail, or that shifts the trajectory of this transformation. So it gives me a chance to say, there's no ineluctable systemic historical necessity or systemic requirement for this to happen. All of this happens because of the balance of power, both within the bureaucratic field and within sectors of the bureaucratic field, and between various agents who are outside the bureaucratic field and are vying to capture elements of the bureaucratic field and redraw the perimeter of the state, redraw its mission, redraw the priority, redraw the modalities of its intervention. So all of this is up for grabs. And all of this, in fact, if I had one critique of this model, it would be the opposite. It's everything becomes a struggle. You know, everything becomes historically determined by the balance of power in this subsector of the bureaucratic field. And I would say, yes, that's exactly how think history happens. Is that, but it's struggle under constraints. That is, you don't struggle freely, you come with a set of resources, you face an opponent that has a set of resources, and you face it within a structure, that is, within an architecture of the state that allows you to do some things and doesn't allow you to do other things. Let me give you a concrete example. The politicians in Austria wanted to import, they were very active in importing the discourse of zero tolerance policing. They went to New York, they traveled to New York, they were fascinated, they came back from their trips to New York saying, we want to do zero tolerance in Austria. We are tired of this, in particular, Eastern migrant criminality on the streets of Vienna and so on and so forth, which are bad for tourism and bad for citizenship. And so we're going to roll out zero tolerance policing. You know who were the resistance came from? It didn't come from groups outside the society. It didn't come from immigrant group, activists. It didn't come from political parties. It came from the police. The police is a very entrenched, very organized, very professionalized bureaucracy inside of the Austrian bureaucratic field, with a long established tradition and a very deeply rooted in objectivity and in subjectivity sense of its own mission, of its own eminence, of what it means to be a proper Austrian policeman. It comes from, really from the historical experience of the Prussian Empire all the way back. And they didn't budge. And the politicians were gesticulating and saying, we want to do zero tolerance. And the chiefs of police of Austria said, not with us, not us. We will not. And so internally, so there you have to go inside of the right hand, inside of the penal sector of the Austrian bureaucratic field, and understand what were the historical conditions that led Austrian police chiefs to both have the structural position, location, resources to resist. For instance, they can't be fired. They can't be fired, they can't be moved, their careers are guaranteed. They are isolated structurally from politicians. So their positions, they're untouchable, but also they have to have the desire, the will to resist. They have to have the oomph, the energy. They have to be able to get up in the morning and to suffer, to read the newspaper and to see they're being vilified by the politicians of their own party. And they have that because why? Because they went through training school and because they acquired this libido policiais, the desire to be a proper policeman. So you have the conditions of resistance, both objective and subjective, are given for that policy to remain merely a rhetorical device that politicians use, and to actually lead to no change in the policing practices of the police, and to produce the result that Austria is one of the few countries in continental Europe where you haven't seen a rise in the incarceration rate, because your police refuses to operate essentially as the social sweeper for urban marginality. And so it is all struggles, and the key notion to introduce, to make central the struggle is the notion of bureaucratic field, and I invite everybody in the room to go and read the article by Bourdieu, Structure and Genesis of the Bureaucratic Field. It's available in English, 1993, Sociological Theory. I remember I translated it. And it's really a fabulous instrument to begin to rethink the transformation of the state. And then I will send people, for those of you who read French, a new book, the first major posthumous book by Pierre Bourdieu, was just published last week in France. It's a 650-page book. That is his lecture course at the Collège de France between 1988 and 1992. It's called On the State. And it provides several models of the state as the central bank of symbolic power, the agency that has successfully monopolized the capacity to assign identities, to establish categories, to inculcate the vision of the world. And it gives us fabulous instruments to begin to rethink the current state's transformation that we are witnessing.
Thank you very much. Before we stopped, I think one of three questions.
Three quick ones together.
Well, I want to ask you one thing, and it's related to the big picture that you painted on the other side of that whiteboard, and this whole kind of functionalistic apparatus that is really, I mean, I agree with the Håkan, you want to see all the human beings, so to say, struggling within this picture. And if you look upon what's happening in Europe today, I mean, isn't what we are seeing now on the European continent is, in a way, that this model is threatened, so to say, by people who are involved in different kind of movements that have different kind of ideas about how this picture would be changed. And you do this analysis of post-industrial kind of society, but you don't have any, so to say, class analysis that is related to that. I mean, what's your relation to that kind of theories around the precariat, for example, that Guy Standings, which is painting almost the same kind of picture, but has another kind of which your kind of class analysis is related to industrial society, uh-huh. and his is related to post-industrial society. Okay. So, and his idea of the precariat is also related to that. There are not just, I mean, I know that you are using the word as well, but you use it in a quite another sense, because he also have this. It's open towards, so to say, these social stratas that are, so to say, knowledgeable, that have education and so on, but are in the same kind of precarious situation on the work side. So, have you any idea about that?
Yes,
relate to what's happening in Europe today.
Yeah, let me give you the class analysis version of this. What you have at the bottom is the formation of the precariat, of the precarious fractions of the proletariat, the marginalized sectors of the post-industrial working class that is marginalized and is being marginalized by two forces, or three forces. One is the objective fragmentation of wage labor. It is the transformation of the labor market. It's not that people are becoming detached from labor. It's labor is detaching them from the center of society. So one vector of precarization of life is wage labor. The second one is the ethnic division, is the reaffirmation of the centrality of the nation because of the globalization and European integration and so on and so forth, and the reaffirmation of the centrality of ethnicity, whether it takes or not an ethno-national form, also means that those who are not part of the right category, nationals versus foreigners, or not right the right ethnicity, you know, white versus colored, and so on and so forth, means that they are being further marginalized, further discredited, further hampered. Their life chances are curtailed simply because they are a member of that particular category, which means concretely, when they show up to get a job, the employer thinks that they have more negative properties and they are less desirable employees than the others who don't show these properties and so on. And the third element is a spatial element. I believe that the rise of advanced marginality and its real or imaginary concentration in these redoubts of marginality that are the stigmatized neighborhoods of relegation adds further to the marginalization. So we have these three vectors, the labor from the world of work, the ethnic from the world of public discourse and you know, and the media and scholarly discourse, including, you know it's a paradoxical effect of the rise of ethnic studies everywhere, and the growth of ethnic and urban studies and the association of urban with ethnicity. you know, it's good in some ways, but in some ways it plays into the growth and the expansion of the sense that ethnicity is important, that ethnicity is associated with urban, that urban is associated with crime, therefore that ethnicity is associated with crime. So that, and then the third is the spatial dimension. So at the bottom we have the formation of this precariat. And I believe that actually a lot of what is going on in the public sphere, particularly a lot of the discourse that comes from stage managers, is a way of shielding, of hiding, of preventing the constitution of the new social question of the 21st century, which I believe to be the predicament of the urban precariat. I think that the predicament of the urban precariat, in a sense, presents in an extreme and sharply visible form the dilemmas that the rest of the society encounters up to the higher reaches of the society in a milder form. And in part, this is why it's so difficult to constitute it as a public topic of discussion and policy, because in a sense, the insecure middle class fears that this is going to be their fate, and so they would rather look away and rather have policies that draw a sharp boundary between them and those at the bottom than, in a sense, to face the question of the precarization that is climbing up the class structure. So my class picture would be this urban precariat. There is still a very significant established, relatively stable working class, but it is threatened objectively by the degradation of its condition of work, by the increasing national and international competition, by the reduced real wages, by the reduced services provided by the state, by the fact that, you know, a generation ago you only needed a week of work to pay a month's rent. Now you need 3 weeks of work to pay a month's rent, and so on and so forth. And then, so you have this anxious middle class, and then you have, there is a class analysis in Punishing the Poor, it's a class analysis of the creation of an incipient global ruling class. You know, an incipient global ruling class that is formed of a sort of alliance between the holders of economic capital, particularly multinational capital, but also the holders of highly valued cultural capital, lawyers, economists, marketing people, people in communication, who are the technical assistants of the holders of economic and particularly financial capital. But this class is being formed, in a sense, on a transnational basis. It's emerging because it's realm of play, both economic and political play, and it's realm of play for leisure. It really has become the planet. It's no longer, you know, living in the nice districts of Stockholm. It's going every, you know, going on a weekend and skiing in Switzerland, and going on a, you know, on a night shopping in Paris, and then flying back on your private jet, and, you know, and so on. So there is a class analysis built into it. And there is, you know, we want to see, yes, I want to see human beings struggle also, but two things. Before we can do an analysis, a strategic analysis of the struggles that are going on, we have to know what are they struggling over. And from what position are they struggling? So we need a structural picture of the overall architecture within which these struggles are emerging, not only to understand why they emerge, but also to understand, do they have a chance of changing the overall architecture? Are they not targeting the wrong problem? For instance, I believe that a lot of the movements that have gone on in France, but also across Europe, that are concerned with ethnicity, you know, that are concerned with discrimination, with the fate of migrants and so on, is very good, it's very progressive, and we need to support them. But they've had the effect of, in a sense, of marginalizing the social question, and now increasingly it's seen as an alternative. Either it's an ethnic question, or it's a class question. So the more we talk about segregation and discrimination, which in fact, both of which are decreasing, both segregation and discrimination against foreigners or post-colonial migrants are decreasing throughout Europe. But what is increasing faster is the intolerance towards segregation and discrimination. So in fact, the problem is getting better, but our sensibility to the problem is getting greater. So we devote enormous attention to this. There are policies of diversity, of ethnic integration, so on everywhere. But there are no policies of providing universal access to jobs. And there are no policies of remedying what is the structural condition of the urban precariat, which is continued joblessness or facing casual employment as the normal horizon of work. I feel like this is a preliminary step that is needed. You need a structural and functional analysis and you need to provide a map. Once you have a map and once you have a diagnosis of what is the animal that you are facing, then you can say, how can we tame the animal? How can we, you know, how can we train the animal? How can we maybe, you know, change the animal? But until we have this structural map, we can't really do an adequate analysis of the social struggles going on.
Thank you, Mario. I think that will have to be the next time you come. We have to discuss that because your train is going. I mean, it's 20 minutes. We have to be at the station. So.